If 5 years ago someone had told me that I would write a book about a murder, I would have said, you're crazy. But a survivor of an assassination ended up in my house as a house guest. And night after night, exactly like a Scheherazade story, it started to unfold. What had happened to him was that on September 17 in 1992, on a very cool, pleasant evening in Berlin, Germany, and he, along with several others, were sitting in a restaurant when two assassins walked in. It happened all so quickly. He felt something by his ear, and that was the barrel of the machine gun the assassins used. And the moment he felt this, he threw himself back and he ducked under the table behind him, staying as still as he could. Four men died in that restaurant that night, and this person who survived thought that it was for him to make sure that those men aren't forgotten. Such assassinations were happening since 1979 throughout the world. However, this time, something happens that makes this case, this trial, this investigation to be very different from the way every other one had gone. This one investigation leads to a completely surprised ending. And it was that ending that really made me to want to write this book, even though I reach for the remote control whenever I see somebody draw out a gun on television. What makes this very relevant is the way in which justice, no bombs, no soldiers had been deployed, but just the simple execution of the laws, a simple serving of the justice to the victims of this case that made it so historically important and so effective.
So Roya, thank you so much for coming to Hawaii and welcome. We're so pleased that you could make the long journey to join us and tell us about your book.
Oh, thank you. This has been a pleasure, and I've never been here, so it's a treat.
I thought, what a celebration of the rule of law.
Right.
And the patience of the attorneys involved and of the court. And I think what impressed me the most was how dedicated the victims were to continuing on. They were people who weren't familiar with the legal system, and they didn't give up. They kept going. They kept, you know, paying attention, gathering information, sharing information. I'm amazed that they could keep doing that for so long. I just couldn't fathom the patience of the victims. They had such a long road, so many difficulties, a system that they weren't used to. You know, for the judges and the lawyers, as long as it took, this is their job. They want to be professional. They want to be thorough. For the victims, how did they manage to keep going?
You know, in responding to your question, I have to, prior to coming to the answer, I have to take a detour and tell you about the writing experience. Just because I suffered a great deal of making the choices that I made, and those choices were often challenged. And one of the things that I really wanted to write about was the patience of the victims. Because for the victims who were members of the Iranian exile in Europe, and specifically in Germany, this was a major education. And my publisher kept saying, but they're not the important people. The important people are the judges and the, you know, heroic prosecutor who
Much as we like to hear that. We know we're not the important people.
I mean, without the prosecutor, without those judges, this case would have never gone the way that it did, and would not have become the landmark that it did, that's for sure. But I think to use that story to bring the spotlight onto the lives of people who live in the shadows is something that deeply interests me as a writer, that I think it's for me to give those voiceless people a narrative voice. So they were the people in whom I was interested, and I'm delighted to know that you think that was partially the right choice to make.
Absolutely.
I think that they were as patient and as vigilant as they were because all of them were democratic activists in Iran under two regimes, under the dynasty of the Pahlavis, which fell at the time of the Iranian Revolution in 1979, and some of them were still in Iran working against the current regime after 1979, and then little by little they had to flee because their lives were in danger. A lot of their colleagues and collaborators were being arrested, rounded up throughout the country. Once the civil liberties were being chiseled away after the spring of freedom in Iran immediately after the 1979 revolution. And therefore, for them, this trial was the first time in their lives that the thing that they had been fantasizing about all their lives, a democracy, was at work before their eyes. This was the thing that they had gone to prison for in Iran, some of them under both regimes. This was the thing that they had dreamed of all their lives. They had given up their careers to become underground activists in order to make it possible for a trial like this to take place in an ideal Iran that never came. And therefore, when the trial began, which, by the way, none of them had thought it ever could, they couldn't help themselves but change everything in the world, in their lives, in order to accommodate the court schedule. So if they had daytime jobs, they gave them up, and they started working night shifts because they had to be in court, because they wanted to watch this. And I think, you know, nowadays everybody's talking about, you know, cultivating democratic movements, strengthening democratic forces in the Middle East. I think this trial was the best democratic education that at least a group of Iranian exiles have ever received. It was hands-on, eyes-on experience that nothing else could ever replace. And to some degree, they became addicted because they carried on with subsequent trials that went on with the same cast of trial attorneys and prosecutors in the same courtroom for at least another 2 years on a related case.
So this trial ends with that eloquent statement by the judge and then dancing in the streets.
Yeah.
Do you have dancing in the streets happen often when you make
a judgment? I don't think anything I've decided has caused dancing in the streets. Rick?
The side that wins may be happy, but beyond that, not so much. But then that's, law is routine. And what we should be able to celebrate in the United States is that it is routine. You anticipate resolution via court as opposed to resolution via revolution or power.
Mm-hmm. Right, and I think, you know, the beauty of this case is what you just stated, that it was resolution through justice. But it's also resolution to something that we think is only possible to resolve through military means. There was, at least in this case, a resolution to an ongoing case of terrorism by the government of Iran against Iranian dissidents throughout Europe that the force of this judgment cause to cease, that as a result of this judgment, all EU member nations withdrew their ambassadors in protest from Tehran for a period that lasted for 6 months. And now the Iranian government was facing more than one problem in explaining itself to the nation. The Iranian government thus far had to explain why it had no diplomatic relations with the United States. But now the problem was multiplied by the number of every European country that existed. Now it had to explain why there was no diplomatic relations with Finland and Switzerland and France and Italy. And therefore it became an insurmountable political problem internally for the government of Iran. And therefore what it had to do was to put a stop in persecuting dissidents around the world, which was incredibly important for the dissidents themselves and for the accomplishment that it was against the terrorism that was perpetuating by the government, that in no other terms the regime had ever been forced to stop other than this. So a tribute to what you do.
When the court process started, were there protests or complaints or those who said this was going to distract attention from what should be action, be it underground movements within Iran or raising of funds for action against the Iranian government? And were there those who wanted to call to arms instead of call to court?
Surprisingly, no, because the protesters who were Iranian dissidents in Europe and most significantly in Germany were certain that Iran would prevent the trial from starting. So what they were pushing for was the thing that they thought they would never be granted, which was a fair trial. And therefore nobody was gonna go beyond what would already be a dream that they were certain would never be delivered. They thought, we ask for the trial, we are certain that because of great trade relations that existed between Iran and Germany in the early 90s, and in fact, what's historically really significant is that Germany had stepped into the place of the United States once the U.S. Embassy in Tehran had shut down. And it was a huge moment for Germany and Germany's presence in the Middle East to keep that relationship, to keep that foothold in Iran. And, you know, the assassination of four Iranian Kurdish leaders at just a little known restaurant in Berlin was in no way, shape, or form going to stand in the way of all that. Therefore, what everybody wanted and were certain that they would never be granted was a just trial, which they were surprised to get.
Can I ask, how were people in Iran getting their information about what was going on in Berlin, and how were they reacting?
Well, unfortunately, this was before the era of internet,
yes,
or the availability of internet to the extent that it is today. And therefore, much of this information was reaching Iran through various broadcast stations, the BBC Persian broadcast, the Voice of America Persian broadcast, and other exiled broadcasts from various corners of the world. So they were receiving it in bits and pieces. The thing that was fundamentally critical in what I believe strengthening the hands or providing an education for others inside the country when it comes to this trial was the fact that a group of intellectual elite and journalists, especially when the case was completed, began to take an interest and began to read up on it, you know, reach out to foreign news broadcasts, read the originals in German and English coverage of it. And then they started to without any trials being held in Iran, they started looking into certain unsolved murder cases within the country. So these were cases of murders against opposition members or artists and writers inside the country that had occurred, but you know, were open, mysterious, unsolved crimes. And so using the blueprint of this trial and precisely the steps that this prosecutor had taken, they went about investigating those cases. And they came to precisely the same conclusions as this court in Berlin. And by the time they started to publish the results of those investigations, the civil society in Iran erupted, and the reform movement that has never really ended up in serious reforms in Iran in any event owes its birth to the publication of the results of those investigations in Iran, which were deeply and directly affected by this trial. So the way the story unfolds is that the chief federal prosecutor in Germany on September 18, 1992, wakes up and hears the news and makes a few phone calls and decides that this is a case that he should immediately assign to one of his federal prosecutors, which he does. And he, after making this decision, about a year later, a man whose political and professional career in Germany was very much on the rise, resigns from his post, or rather, I should say, is forced to resign from his post, and his political career ends. And it's precisely because of his insistence on keeping the prosecutor who had been appointed to go about this free, I mean, giving him a free hand to pursue this case to the most extreme extent possible, which was entirely against the recommendations of the German administration at the time. They knew the Iranian regime had to be involved even before the investigation began, and they knew very much that it was to the benefit of trade and economic relations and diplomatic relations to keep the scope of the investigation as limited as possible. And what the chief federal prosecutor insisted on was that no, there could not be placed any limitations based on any concern other than the pursuit of justice in its fullest. And he lost his career over this. I met him in Germany. It was, and I think I was particularly lucky because most journalists who had covered the story had left the story when the judgment had been issued. So at that time, many of these people were silent for one reason or another. They had chosen not to speak. By the time I got to them, the story was almost history. And now they were ready to speak because they wanted to have said their piece. So I ended up getting him to speak, whereas I don't think anybody else had had such a candid conversation with him. And I found his account really moving. And even though he was a politically conservative individual, you know, he, under other circumstances, he might have decided that it was to the national interests of Germany to go, you know, to make allotments toward Iran, he very strongly felt that the streets of Berlin, the streets of German cities, had to be kept safe, and nothing else, no other interest should supersede that. And and I found that extremely compelling to watch him be turn into a 110% patriot to say nothing else replaces the value of the safety of our streets and our nation, and no matter what those interests might be.
There's an interesting parallel, I think, in some of the Navy JAG officers mm-hmm. at Guantanamo, mm-hmm. who knew that if they did the defense the way they believed the rule of law required them to do it, they would endanger and actually end their careers in the Navy, and they mm-hmm. went ahead and did it. Mm-hmm. So prosecutor and defense have a belief in the rule of law sometimes, which mm-hmm. is admirable and really breathtaking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And in this case, it was admirable and breathtaking with ripples and ripples of consequences that affected, whose effects went far beyond that courtroom. They affected the exile community, who was that patient, deeply changed them from shadow immigrants into diehard German citizens. It taught them what it meant to be the citizen of a country, any country, in the West where there was a constitution. And then it seeped into the civil society inside Iran. And I think it was a serious blow to the consistent acts of terror by a rogue regime that had thus far not bent to any other international demand to cease these operations. You know, Iran had been told in various secret meetings over and over again, stop. You know you're doing this. We don't want you to do this. And they had even made promises to do so, and then they had gone around continuing with those attacks anyway. So to think that a prosecutor in a court of law accomplished what heads of states in secret meetings had not is just very uplifting.
It's interesting to me to hear you describe the prosecutor mm-hmm. who risked his career as patriotic. Mm-hmm. Here, where we have jurors, that I tell them that when they come for jury duty, they almost always enter the courtroom thinking, I hope I get excused. I hope I don't have to spend 2 weeks in this trial. And I always tell them, this is an act of patriotism. You're preserving the American system of justice. You don't have to wear a uniform to do this. And sometimes, after they've served as jurors, they tell me they remember that. And I think the idea of broadening the concept of what it means to be patriotic and to mm-hmm. preserve things for your country, I think that comes out really well in your book.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm still wondering, and perhaps you can shed some light on this, why a case of this significance has remained so unknown.
What do you think? I think the procedure is so different from ours. Not the thought process, not the work. The court procedure is so different. I don't know, I mean, the idea of no record for such a long trial, no official record anyway.
It requires a translation more than language, but the whole process is very different. And in some respects, there are atrocities everywhere you look. Mm-hmm. Since then, it's a sad commentary, but there's no shortage of things to wring our hands about. Mm-hmm. This week we have an explosion at the Boston Marathon. Mm-hmm. And so, with the passage of time, with the difficulty of understanding how the system worked there, this is one chapter, and it's worth reminding people of a chapter. There are lots of other chapters too. Mm-hmm. We have our own problems, Guantanamo, you mentioned, and need to look inward sometimes at what we're doing within our own house and how the system, the rule of law, is actually depending upon individual sacrifices. Mm-hmm. If the rule of law really prevails, that prosecutor does not put his job on the line. Those JAG lawyers do not put their careers on the line. But freedom's not free. And in this case,
individuals have to put their careers on the line, and sometimes more, mm-hmm. to protect the legal process. Mm-hmm. I doubt that the prosecutor understood the ripples that would flow. He was determined mm-hmm. to keep the streets of Berlin safe, mm-hmm. that pursuing this prosecution would have such ramifications in Iran, throughout the European Union. I doubt that he was thinking in those terms. He was mm-hmm. simply trying to do his job.
Right, right. And that's what makes him such a great character, because he was very hard to interview, because here I am saying, you are my hero. And he sits there saying, I'm not a hero. I went to law school. This is what they taught me to do, and I did my job. There's nothing heroic about what I did. But when you actually peel away at the story, and especially at the fact that he had a fatwa issued against him, you know, and it was the kind of fatwa that drove Salman Rushdie underground and made him miserable for many, many years, but it didn't drive him out of the courtroom, and he continued to show up day after day. So yes, it's true, while so many other cases have come and gone since this, I think there are many things about this that make it completely relevant, and in fact provide, I mean, this case becomes, and the judgment provides, a fabulous example of what possibilities are with respect to similar cases that are ongoing, you know, involving the Middle East, cases of terrorism, and the potential for all the good that might fall out from it. I think the fact that the international community spoke with one voice, in this case with the government of Iran, forced Iran to really honor a promise that, you know, nothing else, not the sanctions, not any other pressure has ever brought Iran to accept. So I think you guys are clearly capable of doing a lot more than you think.
I don't have a case that's going to have such an impact on the world.
Let's hope not.
But I will say, I found it really inspiring to read about participants in another legal system who did what the people in your book did. That was mm-hmm. an inspiration, even though whatever I decide is not likely to have that kind of an impact. Although I hope what I do will not be reversed by my colleague sitting next to you.
We'll look into it.
Yeah.
It's interesting that the importance of procedure mm-hmm. is one of the things that I've had a few conversations with people involved in war crimes tribunal work. Mm-hmm. And we cling so tightly to our own procedure so that at The Hague, even in the Commonwealth nations and the Americans, you do that, we would never do that, you know, in terms of how they present evidence, mm-hmm. for example, which ties up those tribunals forever and ever. Mm-hmm. So we have this bearing witness function for war crimes tribunals, for mm-hmm. example. And certainly history has its claims, and that's one of the functions that that's supposed to serve. But procedure can get so tangled, mm-hmm. we can just hide behind it or use it for delay. Mm-hmm. So both the ends and the means have to be legitimate.
Right.
And often they don't seem so.
Right. Well, in fact, the defense, the perpetrators were certainly using various testimonies to drag on the trial, hoping that the exhaustion would set in and people would simply lose interest and forget about this case and. It didn't happen, but that certainly was one of their maneuvers. Mm-hmm.
And as Rick said at the beginning, a lot of it has to do with what your expectation mm-hmm. is, and that, who knows where it comes from, mm-hmm. and it's often disappointed, and yet it prevails, mm-hmm. or so we hope. Mm-hmm. I was sitting in a very boring meeting, and I sometimes play word games, so I wrote mm-hmm. rule of law, and if you rearrange the letters, you get awful lore. But it turns out there's a big difference between lawful lore and rule of law. Although a lot of nations say we follow the rule of law, mm-hmm. and to us, at least, it looks like awful lore.
It's something that's easier said than done. I mean, you can have, and nations have had, show trials.
Yeah, exactly.
They have a process which appears to apply law. Nazi Germany, the court stayed open. I think we had a presentation a few years ago. One judge left. The rest just stayed in place and kept marching on. Mm-hmm. So it's more than process. It's substance. Mm-hmm. You have to take seriously the obligation to be independent, to apply the rules that have been generated for that government and that society. Federalist Papers, Madison says, if men were angels, we wouldn't need government. But we're not. And so government is intended to limit and control and direct people. And law is needed to limit and control and direct government, because government is made up of people that, if given the opportunity, will abuse it. I know nothing about the details of Iran, but I have no doubt that the government takes the form of legitimacy, appearing mm-hmm. to abide by the rule of the laws that they recognize. But they need to be called to account when, in fact, they're playing behind the curtain in a very different way. Mm-hmm. And that's what, in this case, the prosecution, after the episode in Berlin, called upon them to do. They couldn't suppress that because it wasn't their own system, and they hoped to suppress it through applying trade and other pressure on Germany. It turned out they couldn't do it that way either, and mm-hmm. suddenly, to everyone, what they did was revealed.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's how the rule of law is supposed to work. Mm-hmm. We can only hope that it does.
Well, it did in this case, and I think your reference to Nazi Germany is the right one, because the word Holocaust or World War II was never mentioned throughout the time that I was doing research or interviewing this story, but it was very clear that the circumstances had been such that it reminded everyone in the courtroom of the precedents which had been, post-Nazi trials, and the fact that here was a ruling regime that was still in power, that was potentially incriminated in crimes, and that regime was really that regime was on the stands in absentia, but elements from that regime were on the stand in that courtroom. So I think it was in so many ways so reminiscent of what Germans were ashamed of and didn't want any part of, that that to my mind this in fact is the victory of Holocaust. This is a lesson that that they had learned, and so many millions dead. It contributed to justice being served in a completely unrelated case. Half a century later, but you could see, in talking to the judges, in talking to the attorneys and the prosecutors, that nobody wanted a guilty conscience anymore.
Well, the Nuremberg trials were especially interesting because they had a lot to account for, a lot to publicize, a lot to let the world know. It was not purely a victor's justice, but it was important because it wasn't purely a victor's justice. In fact, there were some defendants who were acquitted through that process, even in the face of substantial pressure to convict. The movie Judgment of Nuremberg portrayed much of that pressure. I think the goal was to indoctrinate, perhaps, or teach Germany the importance of an honest legal system with independent jurists and independent prosecutors, so that even in a context where Germany was being called to account, there was an application of justice. Mm-hmm. Whatever it was, a half century later, Germany applied that, mm-hmm. and it's to everyone's benefit.
Yes.